morning. Welcome to all of you gathered here, and to those who are watching from home, may this be a blessed day for you as we worship together. To let you know as well that I got an email this morning that a few people from Uganda will be watching at 11 o'clock this morning, and so we're excited about that. So welcome to them as well. Just a few brief announcements. This Wednesday, again, the Christian Ed will present their hike and letterbox. They're meeting at Sunnybrook State Park on Newfield Road. If you know, just follow Newfield Road, and you go past the big dam, and then past that, and it's on the left there. It's going to be a letterbox thing, so if you bring your stamp or pad, if you don't have a stamp, just I know they have an extra one. So again, that's 4 o'clock this Wednesday at Sunnybrook State Park. Tuesday afternoon, our Bible study continues with You'll Get Through This. It's at 1 o'clock. If you're unable to get it through Zoom, you're welcome to come to the church, and we'll broadcast it through the TV in the fellowship hall there. Monday night, the Bible study, Esther, is continuing again through Zoom, and if you'd like to join that study, you're welcome to. I think we'll be going on to Ezra and Nehemiah coming up next, so I hope you'll join us there. And this next Sunday is Communion Sunday, so for those who are at home worshiping, we will have the communion cups packets outside all of week from 9 to 3, Monday through Thursday. Today's short, Pastor Jonathan has gone off this week, so it'll just be available Monday through Thursday, 9 to 3. If that's a problem and you can't get down here, just call, leave a message, and we'll make sure you get them. Otherwise, if you're worshiping with us, when you come in the front door, they'll be there on trays for you to pick up. You don't have to come down during the week for that. But we look forward to sharing in that worship together. And as we prepare ourselves for worship, from Timothy chapter 3, 16 through 17, we read, "All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work." May the Lord bless his word, bless the reading and the hearing of it, that we may take it deep within our hearts this day. We'll begin our opening music as we'll join in singing, "Seek Ye First and Thy Word."
Amen.
word and how important it is to be in his word, to know that his word directs us and leads us each and every day. Thy word. Stand as we join together in our call to worship. Blessed and righteous God, your truths and grace are revealed to us as we search your holy word.
We come today to listen to the word of the Lord.
Gracious God, you help us to know you through your holy word, which guides and blesses us.
We come today to worship the Lord our God.
Holy God, we gather to worship and praise you, to learn from your word in fellowship with others.
We come today to praise the Lord our God. Amen.
You remain standing as we join together in our opening hymn, God Has Spoken by His Prophets.
Thank you.
seated. That could be the first time you've waved at some of these people in a long time. Well, as we come to worship, we want to be sure we're ready in heart, mind, and spirit. So let's take a moment in prayer and come into the presence of God together. Almighty God, creator and sustainer of all, we bow before you. We bow before you in worship and in prayer. We come together as your people, united in the love of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In him we find shelter and strength. While others may stumble around us, you protect us from the snares of this world. You have sent your mighty angels to keep us from falling into the darkness. Your commandments shine a path for us to follow. You are a merciful God. You walk beside us when we are discouraged. You carry us when we feel defeated. And we praise your holy name. Your Son said that we are to worship in spirit and in truth. And you have revealed the truth to us, both in your creation and in your word. We have seen your glory and majesty in the world around us. We have witnessed your grace and mercy in our lives. Your word has freed us for true worship. We declare today that you and you alone are worthy of our reverence, and there is none like you. You are our God, and there is none other. We are your people and the sheep of your pasture. We need you, we rely on you, and trust in you as our God. And we humble ourselves before you, with head and hearts bowed, in reverence for all you are. May our actions, our attitudes, and our words declare that you are worthy of praise. We surrender ourselves to you, asking that you speak deeply to our hearts. Draw us nearer to you so we may know the awesome love you have for us. Reveal to us any way we are holding back from you. Help us to recognize the walls of bitterness, envy, or hatred, or complacency that we have built, and help us to tear them down so that we may fully embrace your presence with us. We come to worship you because your Son has made the way for us. Through his atoning death upon the cross, we have been reconciled to you, and we can stand before you knowing we have been forgiven and are redeemed. Through your Son and through your word, we have learned to be the people you call us to be. For he has provided for us his teachings. He has shown us the way, the truth, and the life. Lord, as we have seen, he prayed each day for your guidance and strength. He showed us how important having a prayer life is. And he gave us a model to follow. So in reverence, in truth, and in spirit, we offer up that prayer to you now, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Children's story time. And I'm not ready. I don't see any kids in here, so let's go on to the next part. But I do have one request. I could actually carry this down, but does anybody have their Bible with them that they wouldn't mind me holding on to for a second?
I have my cell
phone. Oh, yeah, I can look it up on my cell phone. That'll take me about a half hour to get to it.
It's small print.
And what do you say? Hold to Leo, is it small? That's okay. Hold on. ages that are here and all the kids at home, we're going to begin with, we're going to be looking at Peter's life. And last week, Jonathan spoke a little bit about Peter. And you know, people in the Bible are not a lot different than we. They mess up just like we mess up. They're not always doing what God wants them to do. You know, last week, Pastor Jonathan shared the story of Jesus walking on the water, and Peter did for a little while. You know, Peter saw Jesus and said, "Call me if it's you, Lord." And the Lord called him. He recognized him as Jesus, got out on the water, started walking, took a few steps, and then began to sink. Well, why did he sink? Fear. Fear grasped Peter, which took his eyes off of Christ, and he began to sink. Of course, Jesus rescued Peter, and they got into the boat. Well, in today's story, we see Peter feel fear again. So, Luke 22, verses 60 through 62. Peter replied, "Man, I don't know what you're talking about." And just as he was speaking, the rooster crowed. And the Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. And then Peter remembered the word the Lord spoke to him, "Before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly. Jesus had been arrested. He was on trial, and Peter was in the crowd nearby. But people recognized who Peter was. And they asked him another guy, "Aren't you the one who followed Jesus? Aren't you a friend of his?" And Peter, again gripped with fear, lies and denies that he knows Jesus. And Jesus looks at Peter. Peter, full of shame for what he had done, goes outside and weeps. There are times when we get so afraid that we think lying is better than telling. We think if we can get away with just a little white lie, maybe if I don't tell mom and dad exactly what happened, or maybe if I tell them Johnny did it, not me. Because we're afraid of what's going to happen to us. But you see, when we lie, when we tell these little white lies or these half-truths or blame someone else, we hurt ourselves. We hurt others, and we hurt our relationship with God. It's never a good idea to lie. And Peter realized that, and he was so ashamed, he cried over it. But what is wonderful about this story is that it doesn't end there. In Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, it reads, "One day Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer, at 3 in the afternoon. And now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg for those things in the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John come to enter, he asked them for money. And Peter looked straight at him, as did John. And then Peter said, 'Look at us.' So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. And then Peter said, 'Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk.' As the story goes, the man took up his mat, got up, and walked. His ankles and feet were strengthened." You see, Peter is no longer afraid. When a man asks him for this money, Peter offers him the only thing he has, and that is the healing power of Jesus. What happened? What happened between Peter outside the arrest of Christ and Peter now walking boldly with the Lord? What changed? You see, between these stories, Peter meets your risen Savior. And when Jesus meets him, Jesus restores their relationship. He forgives Peter for lying. He wipes away Peter's shame and fear. Peter, the man that was once afraid to tell others he knew Jesus, is now the man doing miracles in Jesus' name. Why? What changed him? Forgiveness. Peter, forgiven so that he could go out and do the work of God, no longer in shame, no longer in pain. The past had been left behind so that he could do great works for God. Now, there may be times that you have not told the truth. Maybe you've lied to mom and dad or told a little fib. But I want you to know, even if you have, you can ask God forgiveness, and he will forgive you, because why? He loves you perfectly. He loves you as no one else can love you. God loves you, and he wants you to come to him. And when you come to him for forgiveness, he will heal you. He will take away those bad feelings of shame and hurt so that you can follow him and tell others about him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do need your forgiveness. For there are moments in our lives that we, like Peter, haven't told the truth out of fear. So, Lord, forgive us for those times. Take away that fear. And let us know that you really, really love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Kidding, those are small.
Well, a big part of our church is praying for one another, being sure that we lift one another up in prayer and share our joys and concerns. So let us bow our heads as we do that together. Oh, gracious God of life, we have heard your message proclaimed of old, that in you there is no darkness at all. There is nothing that exists that can hide the light of your presence. Lord, forgive us when we hide in the shadows, failing to heed your call and to rise up and join the work of your kingdom. Send us to do those deeds you have prepared for us to do, deeds of mercy and lead us to feed the hungry, shelter the homeless, touch the sick with your healing balm, and counsel the sorrowing. May we visit the prisoner and welcome the stranger. Lord, we find ourselves in a time of deep shadows, and we need your guidance. We ask that you would keep us from despair when we see that there is no peace in our cities and no security in our schools, and in our places of worship. Lift our eyes towards you that we may see your face shining on us, so that we may walk in your light. May your presence comfort those who are living in the shadow of grief, broken by the loss of loved ones. Give assurance to all who are missing loved ones that the living and the dead are always in your care, certain of being joined again in that unbroken calm, where we will sing your praise forever. Lord, as we bow our heads before you, we offer up our praises, for you are doing marvelous things in our midst. You have blessed this church with security and stability. You have raised up leaders who are now stepping up to serve. Thank you for laying upon the hearts of this congregation the generosity that they are exhibiting as they support the ministries of the church. You have given hearts of concern and compassion to those who are reaching out to show their love to others. And we thank you that you call us your children and have welcomed us into your family. So hear our prayers of gratitude for the progress and healing for Pastor Jonathan's foot, that Ralph Dale is improving from the allergic reaction and he has the proper medication, thank you for those reaching out to the homebound, visiting, giving rides, and calling. We thank you for the wonderful weekend members of our church have had, like Adelaide and the Bertolis. We thank you that Judy Room's blood pressure is down 3 days in a row. And we thank you that her tests showed that she is cancer clear after 3 years after surgery. And we thank you that Linda and her son have found a house in Florida to purchase for him. Lord, as your family, when one of us is hurting, we all hurt. So we ask for your healing touch to be upon those who are struggling in body, mind, and spirit. From our hearts, we bring before you by name Kathleen Moe, who's recovering from surgery, for Sylvia Wadhams at Wolcott Hall, for Rose Rader, for Kathleen Waterhouse, for Bill Romanello, for Ruth Dyer, Charlie Miller, Rosemary Stecker, Joe Truglia's sister-in-law, for Betsy Byer, for Pond Marina, for Lindsay's friend Sarah, suffering with migraines, for John Fabi, who's been hospitalized, and for Gina Nadeau, who is starting another treatment for her cancer. We also ask for your provision for the needs of Eddie's great-grandchildren, for Lindsay's mother, for Jacob McManus, for the Renshaws, for Rosemary Davis, and for Pastor Jonathan while on vacation. And Lord, we pray for your peace and comfort to be with those who are grieving, for the family of Shirley Cooper, the family of Patricia Hardy, the family of Alice Lewis, the family of Betty, Marion Zeroli's aunt, and especially her husband for 51 years. We bring before you our nation and our leaders. Lord, give them hearts of flesh and ears to listen to your wisdom. And Lord, may we, your church, stand tall to be courageous and to proclaim the gospel in word and in deed. Lord, we bring you our prayers. In the name of your Son and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We'll now receive our morning tithes and let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do give you thanks for your faithfulness and for your love that you have shown us time and time again. We are so thankful. Thankful for all you are doing, for all the ways you are working in our lives. We thank you for each and every day. And Lord, we thank you for this church. And we pray your blessings to be upon it. And we pray your blessing upon those, all those who come and worship here, all those who are worshiping from home. May your word speak deeply to their hearts. And in gratitude and in thanksgiving, Father, we have brought before you these tithes, these gifts, and these offerings. And we pray, Lord, that they represent our hearts, the love we have for you, and the thanks and the gratitude. And we ask, O Lord, that you would take these gifts, multiply them, bless them, consecrate them for their holy use, that they would be used for the support of your word and your ministry here in this church. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our two scripture readings, the first is from Psalm 119, verses 9 through 16. Psalm 119, 9 through 16. How can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you. Praise be to you, O Lord, teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. Our second reading is from the book of 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 11. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him, who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these He has given us His very great and precious promise, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But if anyone does not have them, he is nearsighted and blind, and has forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins. Therefore, my brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never fall, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of this holy word. Well, today we continue with number 4 of our LEAP series, Applying God's Word. Applying God's Word to our life and to our life situations. But here's the important part. In the appropriate manner. In the way it should be. Up to today, we have spoken about leaving the past behind and embracing today. And God desires the best for our lives, but we cannot move forward in His plan and His purpose if we are still entangled in the hurts and sins and weights of the past. But we can bring all our burdens to Him, for He has promised He will take them, He will carry them. He has promised to heal us. When He stood up in the synagogue in Nazareth, He proclaimed these words as He quoted from Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because He has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." We cannot allow the past to trap us and paralyze us from embracing today. So we need to turn to Jesus for the freedom and the hope for a more blessed today. You see, each day God proves His love and compassion for us. Each day we need to embrace that love that He has for us. Last week we said that the key to that is seek first His kingdom and His righteousness and all that other stuff. That's paraphrased. All these things will be given unto you. Our lives will be more satisfied the more we long for Christ. We need to put aside the desires of the flesh and to walk in the Spirit where we can fully embrace Him. And only when we have surrendered the past to God and embraced His love and compassion for us can we move forward into applying His word in a proper way. You see, when we're stuck in the past, when we look through the scriptures through that lens, we can often apply scriptures in a very unhealthy and selfish way. Our view of scripture can be distorted by the pain and the sin of our past. When we hold on to the past, we use scripture to support how we will act and what we will say, even though it flies against other words God's book in His Bible. When we embrace Christ today, we can apply the Word of God with the right motives. When we don't embrace the day, we will seek to manipulate and use Scripture for ourselves. The desire of our hearts must be upon Jesus. We need to let go of the things of the world, seek His kingdom first, and try to embrace Christ in His kingdom today. Remain of the world. Now, if we remain of the world, we won't get it right. We can be in it. We're all going to be part of the world, but we don't want to be of the world. We want to be different. And the way that we be different is to apply Scripture properly. If we don't, we're going to slowly begin to crave the things of the world. And we'll begin to lose our focus on Christ. In Matthew 6:24, it says, "No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." Putting our full focus on God, not loving the things of this world, besides money, what do we put in the throne of our hearts that take us and lead us away from God? We need to apply God's Word to our lives and begin with the understanding of what the Word of God is. And His Word tells us in 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17, the Scripture we read at the beginning that was up on the monitors, that all Scripture is God-breathed. God-breathed. God gave us His Word. They are directly from Him. And if we use them properly, they are useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. All Scripture comes from God. All Scripture is the truth and is to believe. We cannot go about picking and choosing the Scriptures that we accept and reject other Scriptures that we just think doesn't fit. The Word of God can be a very powerful resource for our lives when used properly. It's able to help us live godly lives, lead us to do good works, and to bring glory to God. But when we misuse Scripture, we miss out on many blessings. We miss out on joy and the hope that it can bring to our lives. In their original manuscripts, we believe that God's Word is without error and without fault. The Bible is not just merely a collection of quotes and one-liners. I'm sure you've heard it out there, and you've probably heard it from a pulpit somewhere. When the Scriptures speak, God is speaking. And that is why we must approach the Bible with extreme care and be very intentional on how and when we use it. Now, as Christians, we can often misunderstand, misquote, or misuse verses of the Bible. Remember how I said people in the Bible are like us, we mess up sometimes? Yeah, we mess up. We use Scripture the way we shouldn't. I know I have done it. We turn to the concordance, you know. I am really angry today. What am I going to do about that? God has an answer. So you slip to the concordance, and you look up anger, and you follow it down. Ooh, okay. Wow, there's a lot of them about anger, isn't there? So you look, and you say, okay, I'm going to read this one, or I'm going to try this one. And then you find a favorite one that fits your situation. The one that says, man, don't let your son set on your anger, or something like that. Another paraphrase. To me, that means I can be angry all day long until the sun sets in the night. That's misusing Scripture. Or we may hear someone misquote a verse that they thought that sounds right at the moment, so we begin spreading that same misuse without taking the time to study the verse and its author intended meaning or context. We need to discover what the author intended the Scripture to address and use it for that purpose. We can't just pick out a Scripture and say, that one fits, I'll use that. And then we go about quoting it when it doesn't even fit. had a long discussion with Faith on this. She's not here right now. I'll talk to her about it too. There was one scripture we talked about where Jeremiah says, the Lord has plans for you, plans to prosper, not to hurt, that I am, right? You see it in graduation cards, birthday cards. Well, that's misuse of the scripture. Because that didn't happen for 70 years. Well, God was saying, I'm going to be with you during this difficult, terrible time that you're going through. You know, but, you know, if you tell someone graduation, you know, God has these wonderful plans, but you've got to wait 70 years until they come to you. It doesn't work too well. Here's a couple. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. How many have used that out of context, maybe? Where you looked at it and it says, well, sounds good. God's going to give me the ability to do anything. I'm 6'1", I dunk a basketball. Or, if I pray hard enough, God's going to let me win the lottery. Or maybe close that big business deal. Scripture has nothing to do with that. When we read it in context, we see that Paul is at house arrest, and he faces the possibility of being put to death. And instead of being defeated, Paul teaches us that we can endure any and all circumstances because we have a strength that only comes from Christ and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. So we use that scripture when we find ourselves in those situations, when we feel like there is no way out, that God will strengthen us to get us through. Well, here's a good one. I wrote that home. Judge not that you be not judged. Oh, that's a favorite. It's been used today more and more as we seek to value tolerance above everything else. Unless, of course, someone disagrees with your beliefs or lifestyle or opinion, and then you're intolerant, or maybe even worse. Some may even shout out, only God can judge me. Well, that may be someone's worldly theology, but it's not biblical theology. Out of context, this scripture is used to approve all kinds of behavior, including that which is abhorrent to God. When we look at the context and what Jesus was saying, we can say that it's not a warning against speaking out against those things that are not of God. A matter of fact, scripture tells us to go and make disciples. If we're going to go and make disciples, we've got to show people your life, what you're doing, what that is sinful. You need to repent of that sin, change the way you live. We're called to do that. But what this verse is warning us is about us, about self-righteousness and hypocrisy. It speaks more to our lives than their lives. If we're going to correct someone, then we must expect to be held to that same standard. If we judge with hostility, then we should expect to be judged with hostility. Jesus says that we are to remove the plank from our eye before we seek to take the speck out of the other our brother's eye. He doesn't say, don't take the speck. He says, make sure you're right first before you do that. Be right with God. To apply God's word to our life correctly means we need to study and understand the scripture in context before we use it in our lives or speak it into someone else's. We will do more to damage than good if we misuse scripture to fit our own sensibilities. Applying God's words to our life also means we need to be ready to be obedient to his word. The church has done tremendous damage to its standing in the world. I think because they've been preaching the do as I say, not as I do. We have preached the word and not heeded it. We are more willing to point the finger at others rather than to look at ourselves. But in Luke 11:28, Jesus said, blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. If we want to be blessed, we've got to hear the word of God, apply the word of God, and obey the word of God. So let's take a look at few ways that we're able to apply God's word appropriately. James 1:22-25 says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in the mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. So three ways that we can apply God's word to our lives in a manner that is pleasing to him and produce blessings in our lives. The first, we look at the lesson. We look at the instructions that we find in the scripture that we're reading. Because those lessons are powerful lessons. They can actually change our lives if we listen to them and follow them. Rarely do we find scripture that does not speak to our lives. On Monday, we have that Esther study. The name of God is not mentioned throughout the entire book. So what could you learn from a story that doesn't talk about God? Well, if you look, do closer inspection, we see God is at work in the background throughout the whole story, bringing his will and way to fruition. We discover that even when it appears that God is not working, we be assured that our sovereign God is at work and in our lives, and we can trust and rely on him. As Pastor Jonathan related the story of Joseph to us, we saw it as more than just a children's story. You know, whether it's Noah's Ark, or David and Goliath, or the story of Joseph, they're more than kids' story. They have a context from which we can learn. There are lessons in Joseph's story about humility, forgiveness, integrity, and God's favor. And when we search his word for the lesson, we learn those things and they speak to our lives. Secondly, we should not only read scripture that cheers us up. Who likes to do that? Oh, I'll admit it. I don't. I'm a little down, so let's turn to this one. Yeah, that's my favorite. I'll do that one. There certainly is a time and a place to read scriptures that are uplifting. But sometimes we need to read the parts that hurt. When we come smack up against a scripture that speaks to our sin and corrects our living so that we walk in the light. It's important to remember that God disciplines those he loves. And he does that through confronting us with our sin in his word. And when we are confronted, we can learn to repent so that we can be restored to a deeper, more righteous way of living. Our desire that comes from letting go of our past and embracing today includes wanting to be more Christ-like. And we can do that as we apply God's word to every situation we find ourselves in. And finally, we must obey the commands and teachings of God's holy word, all of them. Obedience of God's word is very important to living lives that will fulfill his plan and purpose. If we want to enjoy the benefits of God's word, there's no better way than to obey it. Dwight Moody wrote, "The Bible was not given to increase our knowledge, but to change our lives." Now, sometimes applying God's word to our life is difficult. We don't know where to start. Do I look in the Old Testament? Do I look in the New Testament? What book of the Bible do I look in? Should I use the concordance to help me when I'm looking for something that's going to speak and teach me? Where do you start? With your head bowed in prayer. That's where you begin. Before even opening the book, ask God to guide you, to open your eyes and heart to his word. And yes, if you're not sure where to look, go ahead and look in the concordance, but be careful. And when you're directed to a certain scripture, read through it. Then read through the paragraph in which you find that. And then read through the chapter that you discover it in. And then, I don't know if you want to get to the book, but I think the paragraph and the chapter will give you a good context of what the author is trying to say. Discover that context. See if that applies to your current situation. And always remember will not waste a search. If you get to a scripture and you read it, and you read it again, and you read the paragraph, and you read the chapter, and it just doesn't seem to apply what you're currently going through, don't go back to the concordance yet. God has you there for a purpose. And instead, ask yourself two questions about the scripture you've been led to. What does this passage teach me about God? And based on this passage, how should I adjust my beliefs and my behaviors? Ask God to show you how to apply this scripture to your life. And don't be surprised if he has something even greater in store for you than you ever expected. In Isaiah 55, 10 through 11, we have God's promise concerning his word. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. Every word, from in the beginning to amen, within the covers of the Bible are important words for us. Life-giving words that apply properly to our lives and our situations can bring us blessings and restore us and strengthen us for anything we may face. Next week, we will see that God's word leads us to fulfill his purpose and plan for our lives. As it states in Psalm 119, 105, and we sang earlier, your word is a lamp for my feet and a light on my path. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. That your word is the source for our life, is the source that we can trust in, believe in, and hope in. Help us each day to discover more and more in your word. And lead us to be obedient to it. We pray. Christ's holy name. Amen. Our closing hymn today is Break Thou the Bread of Life.
Oh,
But I'm not going to do it. Yes, it is so important that we truly follow God's word, that it is, you know, this was not a plan for my life until God changed my life. And that came from the word of God. Because that word of God was read every day in my household. As I grew up, my mom and dad brought us to church. We made sure we read scripture each and every day. It was part of our lives. God has a message in his word for each and every one of us, each and every day. So don't let a day go by not being in God's word. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you.